Good afternoon, all of you, and welcome to our fifth Charles Peel Bryan Lecture in Substance Use. It's also Veterans Day, and we especially want to honor the veterans who offer their service and offer their lives to protect us. It's fitting the lecture falls on this day as Chuck O'Brien's first service to the addiction field, and the beginning of his extraordinary career in research, clinical care, and training was through his treatment of veterans struggling with substance abuse. He came to the Philadelphia VA from Walter Reed in 1971, a young naval officer charged with developing substance abuse treatment services for the opioid crisis of that time, which was the wave of opioid-addicted veterans returning from Vietnam. The treatment systems at that time were overwhelmed with self-familiar. And he and George Woody framed this challenge as a critical opportunity to improve treatment through research and to train the next generation of addiction treatment researchers and treatment providers. For many years, these efforts were housed in an old, leaky, converted laundry building downwind of the main VA hospital. From the underwhelming exterior, it would be really hard to imagine the extraordinary goings-on inside. The research advances that had really formed the bedrock for a premier addiction treatment research center in the nation. But the Philadelphia veterans were the immediate and continued beneficiaries of this research advance. The findings shaped addiction treatment for the entire field, benefited thousands of patients, while enabling and inspiring the efforts of all of us to continue this path. My own debt to Chuck O'Brien began nearly four decades ago, allowing me to experience firsthand his generosity, his passion for addiction science.
So you started doing this when you were 2 years old.
That's the next line. You took my line. So his passion for addiction science and commitment to training the next generation. As it's been four decades, John Carr's already done the math. I must have been a very precocious toddler when he gave me months of free naloxone for studies dependent on drug triggers. Then gave me my first position and thus my entire career in addiction research. So my personal and professional debt to Chuck is well beyond anything I can ever repay. And as I look around this room, I see faces of so many others with their own Chuck O'Brien stories who've been inspired and lifted up by him. It's an extraordinary legacy. We're grateful and grateful for that. But the debt this hopelessly large, we of course can't fully repay it, but we can acknowledge it. And we can try to honor the man who's given us and the field a gold standard model of passion, clinically informed, hypothesis-driven research. Dr. O'Brien has received a mountain of awards and honors for his contributions, including his Nobel Lifetime Science Achievement Award. We want our trainees, the next generation of addiction scientists, to reach for this standard to indeed become lifetime science achievers. So, because Pierce and I received the letter to the new Translational Addiction Research Training Grant, we wanted to create a recurrent opportunity to acknowledge Dr. O'Brien's multiple contributions to our field, and to thank him for the inspiration that clearly continues in the new generation. And with the recent milestone of the 30 Center and the leadership of Bob Mack and Hank Fressler, we look forward to creating a group of investigators who will move the field forward with molecular imaging tools that are very close to your heart, Chuck, and that promise yet better understanding and treatment of those who struggle with addiction. Dr. O'Brien, the Charles P. O'Brien Lectureship is intended as an enduring reminder of what you've given to all of us, to the veterans who serve us in honor today, and to the field of addiction. Let's applaud, and I'll... So in terms of the field shaping addiction research, mentoring legacies, and the recurrent need to understand the opioid systems that are so critical to our survival, as well as the opioids that threaten our survival, we could not have a better representative than Dr. John Paul Zubieta, the Charles O'Brien Lecturer in Addictions in 2019. Chris, would you introduce Dr. Zubieta? And after your introduction, I think Dr. O'Brien would like to congratulate John Carr.
Well, it's my pleasure to welcome Jean-Carl Zubieta here today for the O'Brien Lecture. John Carl is from northern Spain, and in his education, he bounced back and forth between Spain and the United States. He ultimately ended up as the chief resident in nuclear medicine at Johns Hopkins. In the mid-90s, he got his first faculty position at the University of Michigan, and there he rapidly rose through the ranks to full professor in a couple of different departments. And then stayed there all the way until 2017, where he made a turned out to be a short detour to Utah. Oh, it's
15.
You've been there 4 years.
Wow,
time
felt
So 4 years ago, it was Utah where he became the chair of psychiatry, but that didn't take. So now you can see he's in the process of moving to Stony Brook right now. So we congratulate you on that move. So he's had a distinguished academic career, hundreds of publications, thousands and thousands and thousands of citations. Your fan club just showed up in the back. Sorry,
oh, wow. Folks,
we're running out of seats. So as you guys all know, his research is focused on, as you see here, opioids and pain. But he's also done very influential and interesting work on the placebo effect, various placebo effects in school. He has many accolades and awards, but the one thing to sum this all up, I can tell you, is that Giancarlo Zubieta is Chuck O'Brien's time assignment. As far as I'm concerned, that's the highest grade.
My words failed me. I am so happy. It's a thrill for me to hear my name in association with these great scientists. I want to thank Anna Rose and Chris and everybody on the faculty for putting this together, and especially. This is going to be a really great lecture, so I don't want to take your time away from the great science, but I do have to give you something to remember us by.
Well, what's that?
This is an opioid neuron.
Ha! I love it! Beta endorphin as a matter of fact.
It produces endorphins.
It goes right onto your lapel, Giancarlo, right now.
Right now.
Yes, I am.
I have admired this man for many years. He's done really great work. Endogenous opioid systems.
That's okay.
Incredibly important. And you're about to hear the best explanation of the current status that you'll find anywhere. Thank you.
Somebody who I admire in my career. As a matter of fact, my favorite quote regarding such perceptions actually comes from Chuck when he wrote in one of his other papers, that when you give somebody a substance of abuse, and at the time I think we were thinking about alcohol, that some people just take it and it's fine. It's not a big deal, doesn't bother them. It's not an issue that, you know, because later on, there are some people that even once, at least that one time, that will actually promote a downhill descent into abuse and addiction. So you were talking about individual differences and how we are all different and how we interact with substance abuse and all our environment. And this is a little bit of what I want to talk about today. And that was kind of the theme. So, as I said before, I'm moving from lovely Utah with the mountains to a completely flatter place. So this is what I was doing there for a few years. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about, well, this is actually some pictures. This is actually at the confluence between the Colorado River and the Green River in Moab. If you like mountain biking, that's the place to be. It's awesome, mountain biking. This is actually from a little ranch, the restaurant. Which is lovely, actually, overlooking the bluffs in the area. But now I am. Sorry. No, you hear me?
Yes.
Better. Sorry. Okay. And now moving into the Long Island Sound. This is actually in a regatta this summer. Shortly after moving, it happened to be that the guy who showed me the house was an avid regatteur and a sailor. So we actually got very engaged with the sailing community there, and it's become a lot of fun. So to actually got into sailing. So I'm going to tell you about mu opioid transmission. You know about the mu opioid receptors and the endogenous opioids, but what you probably don't realize is how prevalent they are and how many things they do. So we know, for example, they are involved in analgesia. They are the thing you have to have if you want an opiate analgesic to work. But they are also very much involved in stress responses. You have a stimulus that is stressful or is difficult for the organism. It's producing allostasis. You will activate the system. And in fact, the stress-induced analgesia was discovered veterans or among people who were involved in armed combat, and you know the stories about people who get wounded and then they don't feel anything. Well, that's actually mediated through the endogenous opioid system. But it's also involved in social behavior. If you take an animal, say a rat pup or a mouse pup, and you devoid them of mu opioid receptors, they have difficulties with attachment to the dam. So there is an element of social attachment and behavior that is mediated through this particular protein. And is very much involved in regulation of responses to salient and appetitive stimuli, which is good. It's things like food or appetitive, food, sex, things along those lines, but also mediate the effects of pretty much all substances of abuse, including alcohol, including the opioids, but also the psychostimulants who indirectly affect this system. And I will tell you a little bit about a funny kind of line that we took looking at placebo effects, which is being very well described during expectation of analgesia. The one thing I want you to remember is that when you activate the system and you activate these mu opioid receptors, you are suppressing the relevant response. If you have the anxiety, if you have stress, you have pain, you activate the system, that is then suppressed. And it's also typically activated by a stimuli that is not just the warning sign. It's not like a pinprick that you can remove your hand from, you know, a hot plate or something like that, but stimuli that are relevant to the organism. For example, in a rat, the rear legs are not as affected as the front. A pain in the front legs is much more threatening to the organism than activates the opioid system. So more rostral pain, more sustained, more unpredictable type of stress. And when you think about opioids, you oftentimes think about pain, right? So it's been well described, this dates back to the 1970s, these descending inhibitory mechanisms, partly mediated through the opioid system, in the periaqueductal gray or rostroventral medulla, is the so-called descending inhibition of pain. But if you actually look at the entire brain, opioid receptors are not just located in those pain-related areas or in the dorsal horn, they are actually throughout the brain. And they are in areas of the brain that are very much involved in cognition, emotion regulation, reward, the basal ganglia, the amygdala, nucleus accumbens, thalamus, medial thalamus, rostral anterior cingulate, PAG. So in areas that are motivational, that are affective. So how do we go out measuring these things? You obviously can do these studies in animal models. We prefer to do studies in humans as much as we can. We have utilized typically positron emission tomography. What you are seeing here are just images that were acquired with, in this case, carbon-11 carfentanil, which happens to be a mu opioid receptor selective ligand. So when you start injecting the tracer, it becomes distributed in a manner proportional to blood flow, and then over time becomes incorporated into binding sites. So areas of the brain with more mu opioid receptors appear more in red and white, others in green, and there are areas such as the occipital cortex, which are devoid of mu opioid receptors, and so here in dark. Then we take all this information over time. We then quantify this data. We typically use binding potential or VT as the measure. And then we utilize this three-dimensional data together with anatomical data, typically MR, to develop a coordinate system and a three-dimensional way of actually looking at the images and the statistics directly in the three-dimensional realm, not unlike what you do with functional MRI or other imaging techniques. But when we are looking at this with PET, basically this is the way it works. You have a baseline data, you are injecting the tracer here in red, it goes to your receptor sites, and it's in competition with whatever radioligand or whatever endogenous ligand you have floating around in the synaptic cleft. So it gives you a signal once you are into equilibrium. if you were to release all of this endogenous ligand, in this case endogenous opioids, you then occupy more of the receptors, you displace the signal, and your signal actually goes down. So your activation is a reduction from your baseline to the activated state, and that gives you an indirect measure of neurotransmitter release. You can actually do the opposite. You can deactivate the system. I'll show you some examples of that. And this goes up, so the signal goes up, means you have less release, more binding to the tracer to the receptors, and less endogenous ligand in the synaptic cleft. So when we first began looking at these studies, we were very much interested in stress-associated pathologies, substance abuse, etc., etc. And we came to discover that one of the best ways to stress out an individual in a lab is causing pain. So you take, in this particular case, this was developed by a dentist, funny enough, as a model of temporomandibular pain. It actually works really well. So you take a needle, you take hypertonic saline, 5%, you put it into a syringe, and then you inject that at a certain rate, and that causes pain. That's 5% infusion hypertonic saline. We do it very safely. It's actually very good and safe. And we maintain pain for about 20 minutes. And the way we do this is we ask the patient or the healthy control or the volunteer to rate the pain every 15 seconds. The rating goes into a computer that changes the infusion to actually maintain pain relatively constant over time. That's the pain condition. We also have a control condition, which basically is you expect the pain, but it never comes. And that is simply isotonic saline, which doesn't cause pain, and you do the same rating, so it controls for the non-specific elements of the pain experience. The thing about it is that it's very safe. You inject very little of this hypertonic saline. I think we run at about 1.2 mL over 20 minutes, and as soon as you turn off the infusion, it goes away. So it's actually a nice way of causing pain in a controlled fashion, but pain that, if you think about it, is more clinically relevant. If you were to use a brief pain, like facial pain lasting for 1 second, a couple of seconds, that's a warning signal. That's not an important allostatic component to it. This one has an emotional component, has a cognitive component. You worry about it, you have an emotional response. All right, so what happens when you do this in the scanner and you inject a radiotracer? And this goes to the quote by Dr. O'Brien, which is inter-individual variation. At baseline, you do nothing. You're scanning at baseline, and there is tremendous inter-individual variation in terms of the concentration of myopia receptors in the human brain. Some people have very little, some people have a lot. There is a twofold differential, almost a threefold differential between them. Huge. Then you challenge the system, you activate the system. Some people release a lot, like this one. Signal is going down very, very fast, very quickly. And others not so much. So there's tremendous inter-individual variation in terms of not just the baseline, but also how the individual responds to equivalent amounts of pain. But this has physiological significance. Depending on the region, and it's all about real estate, it's like real estate, location, 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 right? In some areas of the brain, the more the release of these endogenous opioids, the more the reduction in sensory elements of the pain experience, things that have to do with intensity. In other areas, this is more related to the affective quality of the pain or the unpleasantness of the pain. In yet other areas, it's more involved with the affective state of the volunteers, as you would measure it with the positive and negative affective schedule, which has nothing to do with pain. It has to do with the negative affective state you develop when you are under a stressful situation. So tremendous inter-individual variation. And of course, the first question is, where is this coming from, right? Well, you always think of genetics. One of the first ones that we looked at was catechol-ortho-methyltransferase. There is a very common polymorphism in about 40-some percent of the population, which is the metallele for catechol-ortho-methyltransferase, which is one of the enzymes that metabolizes norepinephrine and dopamine. And we already knew that norepinephrine and dopamine are highly connected to the endogenous opioid system. The idea was that if you are releasing a lot of this, if you are not metabolizing enough, and you have too much dopamine around, that will deplete the opioids. If you deplete the opioids, you'll have more binding because you are compensating, and you will release very little in response to pain. The less you release, the less able you are to suppress sensory and affective elements of the pain experience, which is exactly what we found. And the opposite is with the VAL allele. The VAL had lower binding, but much more release in response to the pain signal. And it was directly related to the genetic load of the VAL or the metallele. and they were completely correlated with how the experience of pain took place, accounting for about, in this particular case, we ran at about 8%, 9% of the variance, which for one gene is actually quite significant. So the other one is, we looked at sex differences. Well, there's always this talk about who is more sensitive or more tolerant to pain. Who's more tolerant to pain, women or men? Women are more tolerant to pain. We are all in agreement? All right, fine. So the answer is it depends. And women are more complicated, I can tell you that much. But this is why. So if you scan women in the follicular phase of the menstrual cycle, estradiol levels are very low, progesterone is very low. And at that point in time, when you are doing these pain challenges, there is actually less release of endogenous opioids in response to the pain challenge compared to men in blue. And in fact, they had more hyperalgesia when you were doing these studies. And the areas where this was going on was the amygdala, sensory information, nucleus accumbens, that has to do more with salience, thalamus, which has to do with both sensory and affective elements of the pain experience. But we brought back the women, we gave them estradiol alone, and we brought them back, and we took the estradiol plasma levels to about 200 picograms per ml, which is periovulatory, okay? Increasing estradiol alone increased the capacity to release endogenous opioids just within 1 week of this treatment in these women to levels that were actually superior to that of men. So women actually are more able to adapt to the environment through gonadal steroids. And think about it, it makes sense. During pregnancy, which is a time when women go through huge changes in their physical, in their bodies, there are enormous plasma level increases of both estradiol and progesterone, so it's protected. While in other times you may want to actually, you know, withdraw from pain when, you know, you are not, you know, pregnant or ready to, you know, not getting into it. So, so the answer is it depends. So it's not just about pain. So let's talk about other forms of stress. This was initiated by a former postdoc in my lab, David Hsu, who took it in the direction of social rejection and social acceptance, following the line of the involvement of the system in affiliative behavior. So we basically used this kind of game where we presented cards with profiles to individuals, and these individuals picked the profiles. So, you know, they rated the profile as, oh, I would like to meet this person, or I really don't like to meet this person, and then subsequently became rejected by that particular person. This was kind of fake, obviously, but they took it very seriously. Social rejection and acceptance are very strong motivators in our society. And lo and behold, during rejection particularly, there was a huge release of endogenous opioids in areas that partly overlap with pain. So we are talking about psychic pain as opposed to physical pain, emotional pain, in areas such as the insular cortex, the amygdala, the ventral striatum, the midline thalamus, all areas that are involved in emotional regulation. Acceptance also increased the endogenous opioid release in some other areas. And the more the release of these endogenous opioids, the less sad and rejected they felt. So they had, it was a compensatory mechanism of improvement. And in some areas, like the ventral striatum, for example, the more the release of endogenous opioids, the more the desire for social interaction and social attention. So it's a compensatory mechanism, and it's a regulatory mechanism that relates to social function. So what happens when that becomes dysregulated? So we looked at healthy controls and patients diagnosed with major depression. In healthy controls, we see this release that is actually related to, you know, feeling sad and rejected and the desire for social interaction. In depression, it didn't happen. The patients diagnosed with major depression were not able to release endogenous opioids appropriately to actually respond to the negative challenge. And in fact, there was no relationship between endogenous opioid activation in the patients with major depression and feelings of sad or rejection or a desire for social interaction in those areas. So it was a dysfunctional system in major depression. And of course, you think that in chronic pain conditions, something happens. We know, for example, that in chronic pain conditions, dopamine is dysregulated. So we looked at the opioid system. This was done in fibromyalgia in the context of a study looking at acupuncture. I can tell you more about that. It's actually kind of fun. And what we noticed that was that in this illness, which has about a 55% comorbidity with depression, there was a profound reduction in myopia receptor concentrations in areas that are exactly at the overlap between chronic pain, pain regulation, and emotional function and emotional regulation, such as the nucleus accumbens, the amygdala region, and the dorsal anterior cingulate cortex. And the more the reduction in the binding, the more the clinical pain ratings in these patients. So it was linearly related to clinical pain. We also looked at another example of chronic pain. This was done in chronic non-neuropathic back pain. And in this sample, chronic low back pain patients not treated with opioids, there was a reduction in the release of endogenous opioids either under pain anticipation or actual pain conditions. The lower the capacity to release endogenous opioids, the more the pain intensity, the back pain intensity clinically, and the less the positive affect they were able to attain. So they were less positive in their affect, they had more pain, and there was a reduction overall in opioid release based on pain. We also looked at this as a function of phenotypes that relate to potential for misuse and abuse. And in this particular one, we looked at the pain medication questionnaire scores. This pain medication questionnaire talks about how satisfied is the patient with the medications they were actually receiving for pain. And the higher the scores, the less the satisfaction and the more the likelihood that these people will go on to develop misuse, abuse, and opioid use disorder. And in fact, what we saw was that baseline myopia receptor binding in a relatively small sample was actually increased as a function of these pain medication scores, indicating a potentially high risk group for a prescription opioid misuse. So I was looking at this as potentially a lower level of endogenous opioid activity and an upregulation of the system. So not working as well. And what happens if you give opioids? And this is a sample of patients who are chronic low back pain, have been treated with opioids for many years, but they were not addicted. These were people who were taking doses of opioids between 20 and 60 morphine equivalents per day. None of them had been overusing them, but using opioids, just using opioids without misuse or abuse, was actually associated with even larger reductions in the capacity to activate the endogenous opioid system in response to pain. So you have a certain amount of activation there in controls. That activation goes down in chronic pain and it goes down even further in patients who are actually treated with opioids, even though they are not addicted. Meaning that when you are treating somebody chronically with opioids, you are actually disrupting the function of your endogenous opioid systems that are there to suppress the pain signal. So you're actually making it worse. And in fact, this effect was associated also with greater back pain intensity ratings. All right, good. So we talk about all the good things, all the bad things about the opioids. I'm going to switch gears a little bit. And I want to tell you about placebo responses. This actually is from GSK. It's a slide that they gave me from some of their studies. As you know, nowadays, many of the drug companies and pharmaceutical companies have stopped doing clinical trials in the neurosciences. And that's because they have a huge placebo response. There is very little signal beyond placebo for many of the trials. What is this about? Right. So this is a study where they looked at placebo in dark blue against a new drug, drug A, and Paxil, paroxetine. It's been around for a long time. And in this particular case, the drugs didn't separate from placebo. So this was a failed trial and didn't go to registration. All right, so they did another one. It was the same drug A, high dose, low dose, against placebo. And lo and behold, in this one, there was actually separation from placebo, and this one actually went on to FDA registration trials. But if you actually look at the line, you will see that the active drug effect is exactly the same in the failed trial and the not failed trial. And what was the difference was the placebo effect was lower in the successful trial. Like, gee whiz, that's kind of interesting. Of course, this led on to a bunch of different things, you know, in the drug company. Eventually, they dropped off completely, actually, pretty much completely, from CNS trials. So why are there placebo responses in clinical trials? If you just look at clinical data without looking inside of the brain, people talk about natural history, spontaneous recovery. It's not unknown. It's, we know perfectly well that somebody goes into a trial, they have more symptoms, they get into the trial, and over time, symptoms actually decline until they become stabilized again. Improvement in function while under observation. This was described originally at a steel case furniture factory, where they told the workers, look, we are going to be observing you and see how you are doing to make sure that, you know, production is good, blah, blah, blah. Lo and behold, you know, their performance actually improved. So it's called the Hawthorne effect, or improvement in function while under observation. Response biases. Well, you want to please. You want to make sure that, you know, this person who's really nice and nice doctor with a, you know, Spanish accent, you know, kind of goes along with the whole thing. Response biases. And the fact is that we use subjective study points. Pain is subjective, no matter what people tell you. Emotions are subjective. Many of the things that we actually measure are not objectively measured. They are subjective. Therefore, more variable. And in clinical trials, a higher likelihood of receiving active treatment. If you have a three-arm study where you have two active arms and one placebo, you will have a higher placebo effect. Why? Because your expectation of receiving the active treatment is 66%, as opposed to two arms, which is 50%. So it's higher levels of positive expectancy. Higher frequency of appointments. We're talking about social function, right? Greater rapport with the clinician. There's a very famous study about acupuncture where they took acupuncturists that were really engaged. You know, acupuncturists are really engaged with the patients. They are very involved. And others that were like cold fish acupuncturists came in, did acupuncture, left. And others where they didn't do anything. Lo and behold, who got better in that group? The ones that were involved with acupuncturists that were very warm and very involved. So, yes, greater rapport with the clinician, having the same clinician, have all been associated with lesser separation between placebo and active arms in randomized control trials. Social function. So, but, as we said before, more than half of central nervous system trials do not significantly separate from placebo. Well, that's clearly confound, we know that. But, man, if you get better when I'm giving you a placebo pill, I really want to know why, okay? Let's start there. It's a resiliency mechanism. So it all started with pain, actually. In post-surgical patients, or in experimental pain models, such as ischemic pain, if you create expectation of analgesia by telling somebody that they are going to be getting an analgesic agent with certain potency, and this was associated with reductions in pain ratings. And you will say, big deal, this is a response bias. You know, this is a subjective endpoint. Well, not really. This effect was actually antagonized by naloxone, which happens to be an opioid receptor antagonist. And this was done a million times. The first study back in 2004 by a colleague, Weger, who was at Michigan at the time with us, he was using fMRI and facing pain, did a topical cream, it was a placebo. And this was associated with reductions in the activity of the anterior cingulate thalamus insula, and anticipation of placebo was associated with activation of the lateral prefrontal cortex. And since then, rostral anterior cingulate activation and relationship with placebo effects have been now replicated about 10 times, all parties. So something is going on there. So we did this with PET in the first study. And in the first study, we basically use standard clinical trial instructions. We said, look, we are giving you something, and this could be either an inert substance or something that will improve your body's ability to counter pain. It's not true, but it's a form of deception. Placebo was introduced, well, it's actually not true partially, right? So placebo was introduced every 4 minutes intravenously as it was simply saying IV at the site of the subject. And lo and behold, we saw evidence of activation of the endogenous opioid system in cognitive areas like the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, the cingulate cortex, more emotion, the nucleus accumbens, reward mechanisms, and insular cortex, anterior and posterior insula, which are involved both in pain and emotional regulatory systems. But not only that, the effect was ginormous. Okay? If I were to give you 0.3 milligrams per kilogram of amphetamine, and then I were to see the release of dopamine as measured with carbon 11 raclopride, the signal change will be 9%. Our average was 15%. It was huge. It was a ginormous change. Not only that, there was no such a thing as a placebo responder and non-responder. It was kind of a graded response, kind of all over the place. In some areas, like the anterior cingulate, it was more related to emotions, actually, emotion regulation, as it was the insula, while in the accumbens and dorsolateral prefrontal cortex had more to do with sensory elements of pain and cognitive, actually, elements of the pain experience. And so, placebo effects. We talked about central nervous system trials. There is some literature about this. So would you say that Parkinson's disease will have a high or a low placebo response? Think about what Parkinson's response is. Low, right? I mean, by the time you get Parkinson's disease, 90% of your dopamine cells are dead, okay? Well, no. Actually, you have a humongous placebo effect in Parkinson's disease, probably because of compensatory upregulation of the surviving neurons. And in fact, in a clinical trial that was done out of British Columbia, De La Fuente Fernandez, who actually happens to be Spanish too, from Galicia, he noticed that when he gave placebo, when they expected L-DOPA, acetaminophen, there was a clear release of dopamine in the ventral, in the basal ganglia. In the dorsal area, the ventral basal ganglia was related to improvements in motor control, and in the ventral basal ganglia had to do with anticipation of improvement. So dopamine was involved too. So we did the study. So we shifted things around, we switched a few things, we improved our methodology a little bit from the other study, and we did a dual study looking at carfentanil, which looks at myopia receptors, and ticagrelor. We randomized the whole thing and replicated the original findings with a larger sample. Other areas came up, so we saw release of endogenous opioids in response to placebo administration in the periductal gray, huge area for somatosensory control, orbitofrontal cortex, decision making, subgingival singlet, emotion, dorsal singlet, cognitive control, and emotions and nucleus accumbens reward. Dopamine as well. So the more the release of endogenous opioids, the more the improvement in pain ratings for the endogenous opioid system. In the dopamine studies, we also saw release in the ventral basal ganglia. The more release of dopamine in these areas, the more the reduction in pain ratings, and dopamine and endogenous opioid release were correlated with each other. So probably what's going on here is that dopamine is acting as your salience signal. Something is happening. I'm getting something, I am getting better, and I'm releasing dopamine. Well, the more release of dopamine in the accumbens, the more the release of endogenous opioids in the accumbens, in the putamen, in the amygdala, posterior insular cortex, anterior insular cortex, and anterior cingulate. And dopamine release, placebo-induced, nucleus accumbens dopamine release during the pain, accounted for about 1/4 of the variance in the formation of placebo analgesic effects, which is pretty big, actually. So, what was driving this? The other effect that we have people have described, if you ever read a one of these medication, pamphlets, in the medication, you will see that there is a column that says the side effects of the drug, right? And that in controlled trials, the placebo also had side effects. About 15% of patients across clinical trials will have side effects with placebo administration. That's called a nocebo response. You're actually getting worse with the placebo. And that's actually what happens in our studies. In about 20% of people, when we give the placebo, they improve in green. It's about a 15% reduction in pain ratings, a little bit more. But some people actually get worse. They actually have more pain. They have a nocebo response. So we ask the question, what makes an individual a placebo responder, and what makes an individual a nocebo responder? And the answer was, well, we looked at responders, people that had more than 10% reduction in pain during the administration of placebo, and these people release, lo and behold, more endogenous opioids and more dopamine in the ventral basal ganglia, in the nucleus accumbens. That was quite the finding. But then also we asked the question, well, what about nocebo responders? Same story, but the nocebo responders work this way. While the placebo responders in green release endogenous opioids in all these brain areas and dopamine in the nucleus accumbens and ventral putamen, the nocebo responders went in the opposite direction. They released less. The system was activated with pain. You give the placebo, the response was actually going down. So it's the same areas. It's just the opioids and dopamine were going in opposite directions. So that's what, we were seeing as underlying effects for them. And of course, if you have biological systems, you have genetics that control that. Most of these analyses were done by Marta in our lab, who is now at Pittsburgh, actually. And this one is actually one of your favorite genetic polymorphisms. This is the opioid receptor, A118G, which was first described as affecting the response of alcohol-dependent individuals to naltrexone by Dr. Bryan. So what we saw was that individuals that were G carriers that were homozygous or heterozygous for the G allele, which is supposed to be the lesser functional allele, had actually less binding for the myopia receptor, pretty much throughout the brain, in all receptor-rich areas, at an average of about 20-some percent, big effect actually, at baseline. But not only that, is that when you look at the G allele carriers, those individuals, in response to the placebo administration, they had less release of endogenous opioids and dopamine in the ventral basal ganglia, in the nucleus accumbens. So the G allele carriers were also releasing less dopamine and less opioids in response to placebo administration. So you have a first genetic marker of placebo response in these individuals. These people were also had higher scores in the neo-depression and neo-vulnerability scores, and like I said before, they release less dopamine and opioids in these areas. Another one that we looked at, and I thought it was very interesting, because I was really not expecting this, is FAAH. This is fatty acid amide hydrolase. This is the main enzyme that metabolizes the endocannabinoids, okay? There is a very common missense variant affecting about 45% of the population, whereby the enzyme is less active, so you are flooding the synapse with endocannabinoids. There is more on the endocannabinoids. Our original hypothesis was that because we knew that the endocannabinoids modulated presynaptic dopamine release, we expect that these would actually modulate dopamine release presynaptically. It didn't happen that way. The presence of the A allele, the one that is the lesser functional allele, was associated with less release of endogenous opioids in response to placebo administration. But not on dopamine. Didn't do anything on dopamine. We didn't see anything. But we saw this on the opioid system. And funny enough, was associated with greater placebo analgesia and placebo-induced positive affective state in these individuals, but it had absolutely no effect on pain psychophysics, meaning that at baseline, these people look exactly the same as people without the polymorphism. Pain tolerance, thresholds, everything looked the same. But it's only when you introduce these social stimulus, this positive stimulus, cognitive stimulus, that is the placebo, then we saw this difference in this particular polymorphism, which was actually rather large. So this led us to actually starting to explore the endocannabinoid system. And just a few more examples, and then we'll leave it for questions. Of course, you know, we talked about the placebo effect, we talked about pain, that had been originally described a number of years ago. So then the question became, okay, so we are describing dopamine and opioid systems, they have to do with analgesic placebo effects, there is genetic variation affecting that, that's great, all very pretty, but is this generalizable? Are these mechanisms also involving other forms of placebo response? So we did a study in major depression. We took a bunch of patients with major depression, moderate to severe and medicated, and then we gave them either, we told them, okay, we are going to give you a drug that may actually help you. So we called it the active placebo. It was actually just a placebo, but we call it active. And the pills became labeled active. So they took the active thing. And that went for 1 week, and then we had a washout, and then we went to the inactive. And then half the other people started with inactive and then went to the active. So it's basically a placebo, so it's basically a randomized control trial within subjects. And then once we finished with the 2 weeks of doing this, then we went to a open administration of an antidepressant. The vast majority of them took escitalopram, the regular escitalopram, randomized escitalopram, up to 40 milligrams, between 20 and 40, until they got better. So this is what happened. So we gave the placebo in the scanner, and we saw evidence of release of these endogenous opioids in response to placebo administration. Lo and behold, this time, it happened in areas that we know are involved in emotion regulation and in the pathophysiology of major depression, namely the subgenual anterior cingulate, the nucleus accumbens, the anterior insula, amygdala, and medial thalamus, all of them involved in the pathophysiology of major depression. And the more the release of these endogenous opioids, the more the improvement during placebo administration. Okay, that's cute, not really surprising, but it's kind of cute. But what was really cool is that we also saw a relationship between the release of endogenous opioids in these areas and the improvement after the 10-week antidepressant trial. So the more the release of endogenous opioids in during placebo administration in the scanner, there was the better the prediction of the improvement in mood after 10 weeks of antidepressant administration, accounting for 43% of the variance. 43% of the variance, that's ginormous, okay, right there. So, and, which is not the way you tend to think about this, right? So what are the clinical consequences? Well, you know, overall, the remission rates were actually higher in the placebo responder group versus the non-placebo responders. In gray, the placebo responders, much better improvement only after week two. Not immediate, after week two, it's exactly as you would expect with an antidepressant, right? After week two, they get better. Many of these went on to greater improvement in depression symptoms, and the placebo non-responders were also non-responders to the antidepressant trial. So what probably is going on here is that you have two things going on that are interacting with each other. You have a placebo effect, you have a drug effect, you have one that goes on top of the other, and an interaction between the two. So there is an interaction term in between the two, where some compounds, like antagonists, work on pain mechanisms. So you have probably an interaction term between the two, or at least an overlap between active and inactive treatment effects. And that's all I wanted to give you, to tell you. I'll just do some conclusions so you cannot remember. So we are basically showing that endogenous opioid systems are involved in the pathophysiology of stress-associated conditions. You can talk about pain, major depression, you can talk about substance abuse, alcohol dependence. They are down-regulating persistent pain and major depression, as I show you, and they are furthermore so in the context of opioid administration, even in the absence of substance use disorder. They seem to be implicated in resiliency mechanisms, i.e. placebo-induced changes in symptoms with inter-individual variations in stress regulation, which we are actually able to trace to common genetic polymorphisms. So there is biology behind this. And this is relevant not only for clinical trials, obviously, but also the understanding of mechanisms that are related to vulnerability to disease, inter-individual variations, and resiliency to disease, including treatment responses. So where do you go from here? Okay, well, I mean, we have many questions that we would like to pursue. So, do variations in endogenous opioid system function influence risk for opioid use or other opioid use substance use disorders? Are there variations that relate to genetic forms or for other reasons that may actually then influence the capacity to be more predisposed or the predisposition to substance use disorder? We got point in the area of endocannabinoids. Does an integrity of the endocannabinoid system influence things like responses to pain or even antidepressant or addiction treatments? We don't know that. But clearly there's a connection there. And then what is the interaction? Is this additive, as it's been thought about? You have a placebo effect, you have active drug effect, or is it interactive? Tricyclics are known to work on the opioid system. So all of a sudden you have a drug that is enhancing your placebo response, but also your internal pain control mechanisms. So that's kind of interesting. And would also placebo responses, which do depend on this social interaction and social function, do it also imply a greater response to non-interventional approaches? Psychotherapies, CBT, interpersonal psychotherapy. I don't know, never really looked at it. It's kind of interesting. And then again, of course, we are interested in biomarkers. Would biomarkers, simpler biomarkers that we could use in clinical practice, such as inflammatory mechanisms, for example, there are some hints that that's the case, endocrine factors, genetic or a combination of them, would allow stratification in clinical trials to actually reduce placebo responses and clarify the effect of active drugs. And of course, I want to acknowledge our team and our funding agencies over the years, and I'll leave you with this one, which I always like. It was commercialized by AstraZeneca, of course, that's a joke. This is a spoof by The Onion, okay? And the sucrose is placebo, it's 500 milligrams and it's a pill. And it's going to work, right? So laboratory studies have some sucrose to be occasionally effective in the treatment of pain and all these different things. And side effects associated with the use of placebo include all those different things. Thank you.
That treatment with chronic opioids tends to reduce the functioning of the endogenous
opioid system.
Do you also see a reduced placebo in those individuals who've been treated chronically with opioids?
So great question. I'll let you know in about a couple months working on it. So we have a clinical trial designed to answer that specific question. So the question was, you know, we saw that endogenous opioids reduce the function of the endogenous opioid system. Does that mean that also the placebo effect is reduced? My guess is yes, but I don't know the, we have a control trial looking at that precise issue. Not only that, we are looking at two different pieces of that. Is people who actually have misuse for opioids, or at least misuse, some of them will be opioid use disorder. Do these people also have lesser improvement in pain over time, and also lesser placebo responses in this particular group? The trial I'm talking about is one with fibromyalgia, but it has been funded, so that we are working on that right now.
It's a similar question. One way I'm interested whether or not the fact that you get this down-regulation or this reduction of your resistant system function with chronic administration, what are the implications for choosing partial agonists, full agonists, as compared to antagonist treatments, which might maybe kick the system up a little bit instead of reducing it down? Or there could be variability in the ability to do that. What are your thoughts?
That's a great question. I always wonder about that, right? And not a lot has been done to understand that question. There are all these trials that are being done in a fairly non-standardized fashion with low-dose naltrexone, for example.
Yeah.
What is that about?
It's intriguing.
Yeah, it's very intriguing. And people who treat chronic pain conditions in difficult-to-treat populations are saying that there are a number of patients who, on low-dose naltrexone, they get much better.
A really interesting subgroup.
Yeah, it's a very interesting subgroup. Nobody understands it.
Yeah.
Me too. And nobody has looked at that specifically. I can tell you that the experience that we had, this was 10 years ago, when we did a trial with buprenorphine when it was first introduced in the US. And we did buprenorphine, and then we took them off buprenorphine and followed them over time. They're with the partial agonist, or antagonist, for the cap at least, the receptor levels actually went up. So you had a control group, you had the opioid-addicted populations that were treated with buprenorphine. Of course, with buprenorphine, you block the receptors, but once you took buprenorphine off, receptors went back up. So, in fact, to levels that were higher than the controls. So they actually kind of rebounded.
Oh, that's interesting.
That is very interesting. And we never were able to follow up, because it's just hard to do.
Yeah.
I mean, practically speaking.
Oscillation that comes back down.
Exactly. It's just hard to do. It was just a hard thing to do. And at the time, we were mostly working with heroin addicts, and those guys are pretty unreliable.
Oh,
so
I don't know
about that. Well, I mean, it took a huge amount of effort to do this.
We
kept them in an inpatient unit for like weeks to be able to actually do the studies, and
yeah.
It's hard to do that these days. Yes.
When the endogenous opioid system was first discovered, many of us thought that it was only a matter of time before we learned how to control it, and then this would be better than drugs. It would be a natural way.
Yes.
I think, based on my reading, that the only thing that seems to activate it reliably that you can use as therapy may be acupuncture or electroacupuncture. What would you say? If there's anybody, you know, sort of working on that? Because it seems to me that would be ideal to eliminate the need for giving drugs if you could just turn the system on and off reliably.
That I don't have the slide here. I do have one from a study that we did some years ago with fibromyalgia. It was really cute. So basically, in this one, we took women with fibromyalgia and we randomized them to either traditional Chinese acupuncture or fake acupuncture, which they couldn't distinguish from each other. It was done with toothpicks that were non-penetrating in areas that were not key, so outside of the body. So both of them were equally effective. So meaning the pain improved in both the fake acupuncture and the traditional Chinese acupuncture. And they both were better than a weight control group. So, which is kind of interesting. But the funny thing about it is that when we actually look at receptor binding, women with fibromyalgia had much reduced binding in a bunch of different areas. And the more the reduction, the more the pain. The people that received acupuncture, their receptor levels within 4 weeks of acupuncture administration 3 times a week, their receptor levels went back up to normal to actually recover protein in the membrane, while the other ones did not. The other ones showed evidence of release of endogenous opioids, which is similar to what we see with the placebo. But we didn't see the change in binding. And funny enough, there is one paper that was published by a very famous guy who does this kind of work in China from the National Academy, National Chinese Academy of Sciences, that an early paper that showed that electroacupuncture in animal models increased the binding of the myopia receptor like 100-fold over a period of X amount of time. And it was never published in Europe, it was in the Chinese article. We found it later on after the years. But so there is, while the clinical effect of traditional and fake acupuncture was the same, we couldn't differentiate the two, the mechanisms were completely different. One, like the placebo, release opioids. The other one actually changed the protein in the membrane. But no idea why that was the case. But that was, I was impressed. That was published, I couldn't give you the paper. More questions? Yes? They're working on that. So yeah, the question is, he was intrigued by the data on FAAH and the connection with the opioid system. Has anybody looked at CB1 receptors and the opioid system? And the answer is not yet, because I couldn't do the studies when I was at Utah, and that's one of the things I'm hoping to do now. I actually have two grants to look at the effect of both THC and CBD on the opioid system and the CB1 and the relationship between CB1 and treatment response in clinical trials. This was a clinical trial for depression in this particular case, but also the CB1 and the opioid system. So the answer is we're working on that. The studies have not been done yet. The one I was hoping to use was carbon 11 OMAR, but there is another one from Bob Innes' group intramural, which is a inverse agonist that looks pretty good. I'm still deciding which one to go with. Which one? The Merck one? Which one is that? I don't think I really checked that one out. Is it working? Let's talk about it. Yes?
I was just curious about your placebo effect and the predicting antidepressant efficacy. Did you actually do an image or a PET study at the end of the 10 weeks?
No, we didn't have enough money.
Oh.
We just did. No, that's kind of the next one. That's another one that is funded actually too. And I couldn't do it at Utah, so that's, I'm hoping to do that here. Where the, in this particular study, is actually a randomized trial of placebo with an antidepressant, and we image before and after. So we can look at both what the placebo does over time and what the drug effect is over time and the interactions between the two, with the idea that nobody has really looked at the interactive effect. Let me just show you the idea behind that, which is this. Normally, you tend to think about control trials when you have a placebo effect in blue and an active drug, and the two can be, you know, big or not. But what we are really thinking is going on is something more like this, where you have a placebo effect and there is an interaction term between the two, where you can actually improve physical state through placebo administration, as well as through the active drug effect. And the idea is to understand this piece. Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was wondering what happens to the endogenous opioid system in patients who have a history of trauma.
What happens to the endogenous opioid system to patients with a history of trauma? That's a really good question. Unfortunately, it's not a simple question to answer. There is one study that was published by my group when I was at Michigan, where we looked at emotional responses and binding of the myopia receptor in patients with PTSD. These were veterans, military. And it was kind of all over the place. I mean, there was a relationship between emotional responses in the amygdala region in response to Hariri faces, basically. Was it Hariri or it was, may have been the ugly pictures, the ugly picture ones. And the binding. But we never followed up on that. We were hoping to do that. And there is a very interesting hint that there may be something going on with trauma in that if you were to take trauma patients, and this was done actually in Georgia, in Atlanta, for in car accidents. So one of the protocols they follow there in severe car accidents is they give opioids almost immediately to patients who've been treated, who are being coming into with acute severe trauma. And in some counties they do that, in some counties they don't, and they compare the two, and there was a clear improvement or a clear association between less PTSD symptoms after severe car trauma and the administration of opioids. Not unlike what was seen in the Israeli forces with benzodiazepines, which they use a lot of that back in those days. And more recently, there is also a connection with the cannabinoid system, where there is a clear effect of the CB1 receptor and the endocannabinoids on the fear extinction in animal models and in humans. So there is a connection between the cannabinoid system and fear extinction. So if the cannabinoid system is working well, there is greater capacity to produce fear extinction, both in the animal model and in human. So there is a clear effect for benzos and GABA, for opioids, and probably, and looks like, a strong effect for THC and or CB1. So, but the studies are not done yet, unfortunately. Yes?
So, just a wonderful job of doing all the studies that you presented. One thing I've noticed, of course, is the neurotransmission coming from the dopamine, obviously, choline, is a lot of the effects are very symmetric to the sense of the system of neuroscience, which areas are involved. Some data, like this left, amygdala, left, cingulate. What do you think is it about the opiate system that makes the biologics of certain machinery?
Yeah. So the question is, we saw a lot of lateralized effects, and I can give you one. There are a couple of answers. One of them is that the studies that we did with pain were all conducted with pain in one location. It was the left side. So you, with pain, you always see a lateralized effect, and the placebo will have some lateralization. In spite of that, so most likely because of the pain, it happens in both sides. With the emotion challenges, we saw the effects that were right lateralized mostly. And I could not, for the life of me, tell you why. Because I never was a believer on right-left kind of differences. Some people love that literature. I never really believed it very much. I was never into that. But there is definitely a lateralization effect, and I don't know why. That has nothing to do with input. So there is one that has to do with input, which is the pain. So our pain is clearly lateralized, not the problem. But there are studies that are not lateralized, like social rejection or emotional regulatory stuff that they are coming out lateralized, and I have no idea why. And the only way to do that would be to really, really compare right to left and looking at differences between subjects and so forth. All our subjects are right-handed. I don't know. I just don't know. So.
Ha ha ha!